So social nodes work like this. In any given social environment, there are going to be typically 2 to 3 major social nodes. And those are the places of the highest self-esteem, as well as the highest masculinity and femininity in the place. And you want to either associate with and meet and befriend those who are at dead center of those social nodes, or be the center of a social node, create one. A lot of gurus out there will talk about, you know, being the life of the party, you know, being the go-to guy. But this hopefully takes it to a whole new level for you. If you literally were to plot every person in a venue, you would see this kind of scatter diagram, like a cloud, electron cloud diagram, where you would see 3 very dark spots. Those are the social nodes, the places of the highest power, the highest masculinity, highest femininity, and high self-esteem. You want to befriend those people at the center or be that. And so when we move on to part 2 of this program, the very first step of sexual attraction, which I'll just give it to you right now, it's being mysterious, being a source of curiosity for women. You want to really pull that out. And I'll tell you right here that almost every technique or tactic is what they really are, taught by, you know, the online internet men's dating community with all of its little buzzwords like peacocking, false time constraints, social proof, negs. There are all kinds of buzzwords they use. Really, all of those are tactics, and they all do one thing. They show you to be a mysterious guy. They raise questions in a woman's mind. Why do you know so many people with your, quote, social proof? Why are you making these ambiguous comments to me called negs? Why do you have somewhere else to be and you have this, quote, false time constraint? You know, why are you wearing that outlandish clothing? Why? Women want to know. They become curious about you. And there are several scientific reasons why that's the number one sexual attractor. This is where you would have heard it first. But almost everything that you do that is mysterious is going to jumpstart you being a social node, you being the center, one of the 2 to 3 total major power centers in a social venue. That's how to convert a difficult venue into one that works for you more than any other guy, you and your buddies more than any other guy. And Richie, you saw that in London when you were coaching with us recently there. In this case, I had a lot of fun little things I brought with me just because I like being an amateur anthropologist out on the town experimenting in human behavior, really. I had a crazy-looking coat, a fuzzy coat. I had a fake Oscar statue, an Academy Award statue. And we walked right into a club because I had done all the pre-work knowing the owner for a couple years, et cetera, et cetera. And then we brought those girls in with us from the line.
Yeah.
So we could get 10 guys into an impossible-to-get-into place. And once in, we were it.
We were the
social node.
Absolutely.
We were the one singular social node. Earlier in the evening.
That was a big scene, walking in with all these girls and all these guys, a big party with all the stuff going on, everybody's taking pictures, and we were the biggest party in the place. We made the place at that point in time.
So to convert a difficult venue into a great venue for you, be fun. Be the social node. Be mysterious. Have various interesting... Could go ahead and call them props if you want, but props imply they're fake and you're manipulating with them and you really don't like them. I actually like the fun little gadgets I might bring with me. I like technology. I have a projector. I have a laser that creates a dance floor for myself. You know, I have all kinds of great stuff that I really like, and it's fun.
Yep. And sometimes the best props have a story behind them. Best prop I've ever seen was a vuvuzela, which is one of those horns that they blow at World Cup games, because a friend of ours from South Africa was visiting, and he brought a vuvuzela with him from South Africa, Well, we brought that Vuvuzela out with us, and it was great because it had a story behind it. Our friend from South Africa brought it to the United States.
It was a gift. And it was a real gift.
And that Vuvuzela had traveled a long way to get there. And,
that's right.
It made us quite the social node that night.
Like 7,000 miles.
Yeah. And like having the Stanley Cup, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. And you remember one restaurant we went to that's also a giant karaoke bar. The owner was there. He happens to be a Hollywood actor. And I was blowing my Vuvuzela joyfully. And he happened to have his daughter there, young girl. And she loved the sound. And he came up to me and says, "Hey, I'm, you know, so-and-so. You may recognize from this film and that film." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah, yeah." And he goes, "Hey, would you... play that Vuvuzela for my daughter because she thinks it's great." And he was the owner. He's like, "Anything I can do for you, anything I can do for you."